It's Q&A Friday on the show. That means time to give way to the money questions you've sent us via email, Twitter, and Facebook. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On the Money. Joining us to answer your questions is registered financial planner Charmina Bautista. And also with us are, of course, the ladies Salve Duplito and Melissa Hecolea. Hello, ladies.
Hello, Edric.
Hey. Q&A Friday time. Time to get busy and wake up for the questions we have today.
Exactly.
Let's get started.
Okay, the first question comes from Regina. She says, my husband and I were forced to change our money habits when he lost his job 2 years ago. This was our family's best lesson on delaying gratification. Two of our kids are in high school now, and I can sense that they sometimes feel the pressure to have what their classmates have. I tell them that we have to make do with what we have for now, and that we can just save up for gadgets they may need in college. How else can I reinforce the delayed gratification lessons they've learned?
Oh, I remember the story of Jacob and Esau. Jacob said, give me your birthright.
He's bribing him.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
And what did Esau do?
Give it up because give he was
up.
Hungry.
Yeah. He gave up
instant gratification.
Most of us are like that.
It's built into us, huh?
Yes.
Compromise.
We just want it now, especially in our society. Instant messaging, instant noodles, right. Everything is instant.
So, what do we do? I mean, given that, how would you suggest to correct that?
For practicality's sake, they could have a meeting and say what are the important things to them.
There you go.
Exactly.
What are their goals and aspirations as a family? Mm-hmm. As a practical example, in our family, we like to travel. Mm-hmm. What we do is we really save up for it. Mm-hmm. And then this can afford us travel in Asia. Mm-hmm. And now we are trying to save up for our family to go somewhere else.
The thing with delayed gratification is you have to teach your kids to sacrifice things now.
Excellent.
So they can have something in the future.
Yeah, it's
but
that long-term goal.
I would attack it in a different way. I wouldn't want them to think that you cannot afford something.
Sure.
So maybe me, I'd personally say, don't tell your kids that you can't afford it. Tell your kids that you can save up for it so that they can afford it later.
How about
this kind of mentality is bad for our children.
What I would do, my suggestion is teach them to be content.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Yeah.
Instead of saying you can't
have
this at all or you can't have this yet, just tell them to learn to be content. For example, with what they do have, as an exercise in our home, we go around and say, hey, what can you be thankful for? Oh, I'm thankful that I have these toys already.
Yes.
Instead of wanting more, right?
Yeah.
I'm thankful that we can do these things instead of wanting to go to many different places, for example, right?
Yeah,
so
or avoid going
right?
to places where you feel like you gotta have something.
Yes.
So instead of going to the mall, go to the park.
Yeah. And you really
too much eye candy, right?
You shouldn't feel like you have to follow the herd. You should
there
tell
you
your kids, you know what, just because they have it doesn't mean that you have to have it. It's actually not that important. You need to teach them that having what everyone else has doesn't make you any better than you already are.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know,
you don't need those things to feel better about yourself. Yeah, so tell me if this makes sense. So like my kids, when they get all these presents, Christmas season's coming up, instead of opening everything at once, we say open one thing, enjoy it, and learn to delay gratification. So they look forward to opening another one.
Financial literacy is also a tool. The more that the kids learn about what money can do, how compounding interest can help them, they tend to save more and delay instant gratification so that they can buy something else in the future. Let's say if they want an Apple now, they can buy a very small one. If they save up for it, they can buy a bigger one later.
Okay. So, anyway, the next question from Christopher is, is it okay to give kids 10 to 12 years old ATMs for their allowance, or is it still better to give them actual cash? What money management techniques can we teach them?
Our resources are given for a purpose, and when the time comes, this will already be, we are expected to grow them. A while ago, we talked about delaying gratification.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's a very important skill that they learn. So with the basic principles at hand, now, whether ATM or cash, it doesn't matter anymore as long as the kid knows the principle behind the money management skills that they want. ATM or cash, now you have to understand what are the benefits of having ATM. Yes, it's convenient, But also, we have to balance it with the risk involved. Will you allow your child to withdraw by himself? Mm. But on the other hand, it can also perk up the interest of the child. Right. Imagine being part of the whole financial system.
Right.
There are pros and cons, but at the end of the day, what is important is that the child knows what is the principle behind these things, and it can be explained by parents.
Yeah,
so
I'd like to jump in.
Rather than the method of, yeah, go ahead.
I use cash for my kids. Mm-hmm. And let's say I give them 100 pesos per day as baon, but I give them in change.
Per day, huh?
Let's say lang. So I give
I was
it in change.
Get you there. Yeah,
you know
okay,
why?
Yeah.
Because before they leave the house, they leave 10% of that in savings. Mm-hmm. So really in coins so that they can see.
They
it's
can
very
see
visual.
It.
Mm-hmm. 10% in savings, 10% for tithes, and the rest they bring to school. Then if they have something left over, then they can come back home. And then so sometimes at 10 to 12 years old, kids need something very
tangible.
Visual and very tangible.
Right.
Their ATM can be only for their savings, but not for their baon.
Right.
But that's just me.
If
they
were older, I would say ATM.
Because
I think when you have
students.
Cash in hand, you're just going to spend it. And at the end of the week, you see that cash, you're going to get rid of it.
Right.
Somehow.
Makes sense, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So maybe when they're older, when they're teenagers, even before college, actually, because I had one before I was in, when I was in high school, I was quite good with it.
Cash is good budgeting style, kasi. It's easy for you to chop it up. And, you know, if it's all in the ATM, and then you feel like you have a lot of money, and then you just spend it.
So I always think out of sight, out of mind.
That's true.
I can't see it. It's not there. Oh, I've forgotten. My wallet's empty. You know,
makes sense.
You hope your kids think
makes
that. My wallet's empty. I don't have money to spend.
So you make sure you check the life stage, right? What age are the kids?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You employ tactics that, you know.
Exactly.
You saw.
From Maybeth, does a T-bill auction work? How come sometimes bids are rejected? How are T-bills different from bonds? Are both good options for conservative investors?
Oh, that's a lot.
Yeah.
So first,
several questions.
First, government securities like your T-bills and your T-bonds, they are what you call unconditional obligations of the sovereign country.
Okay.
So as unconditional obligations, somehow they are risk-free because it's backed by the government itself, the taxpayers. Now, the question, how does it work? The government has what you call GSEDS, which are your government securities enabled eligible dealers, rather. Mm-hmm. Government securities eligible dealers. So these are the primary traders. So they are the buyers of the treasuries. Now, what happens is that it's in electronic system. What they do is, it's in electronics, they key in their bids, minimum of 10 million, and then the system, which is the automated debt auction purchase processing system, that would now receive it and would queue it based on the rates, the yield rates that they had the bid. Now, it's from the highest yield to the lowest yield, after which the auction committee will decide on whether the bids are accepted or not. It's also through this electronic system that this goes through.
Okay. An auction is basically how the government, the national government, raises money for its operations, right? So that's where they get money from these dealers that you're saying. And every other week, the Bureau of Treasury comes up with these auctions. The difference between T-bills and T-bonds is that T-bills are less than a year in maturity. When you're saying 91 day, 182, and 364 days, that's a treasury bill. Beyond that, it's a treasury bond. You have 2 year treasury bonds, 5, 7, 10, and 20.
We're gonna have more questions for round two. In the meantime, more of your money questions right after this break. So stay with us. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On the Money. Still with us is registered financial planner Charmina Bautista and the ladies. All right, let's go for round Two.
Ding, 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 ding.
Okay. That's right. Go for it.
Randy asks, is it advisable to subscribe to stock rights offerings or secondary share sales?
Stock rights are privileges given to stockholders.
Existing
stockholders. So whether to buy it in the stock market or not, secondary share sales or not. Well, first of all, I'd like to ask you, what is your experience of the company, of your initial investment? So your experience would somehow tell you whether you would want to keep on investing money in this particular company. Mm-hmm. Do you see good prospects in the future for mm-hmm. this particular company? Mm-hmm. Do you see yourself growing and investing further in this company? Now, mm-hmm. to buy it in stock rights or secondary market would be immaterial, because if I want that company, I would invest on it mm-hmm. every from time to time.
But honey, mm-hmm. I disagree with you, because if you like a company, you actually get a discount when you go through the secondary stock rights offer.
Really?
They normally offer it because it's a privilege for existing stockholders, and they give it to you cheaper. Mm. So you mm-hmm. get a lot of discount, and you know, if you, as you said, if you like what this company is doing, if you like what you see mm-hmm. will happen in the future, then go ahead and mm-hmm. get the stock rights offer instead of the open market, because you get a lot of discount. Now, the problem is there are companies that offer stock rights offering because they're in trouble mm-hmm. and they need to raise cash.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's when you try to think about whether the company will grow in the future. It's going to just get into trouble. Then even if the stock rights offering is cheap, you wouldn't want that.
So you should do some research before you decide whether or not. But in secondary share sales, it's cheaper.
Yes, it is.
Okay. And you're saying you can get secondary share sales in the companies directly?
Yeah, only if you're a stockholder. If you're an existing stockholder,
they will offer it to you.
Yes,
okay.
They announce that in the media.
Can you proactively check, or you wait for announcements and then you just take advantage?
I see. Yes.
It's like a sale in a mall and mm-hmm. you just take
that's
advantage.
Right. There mm-hmm. Great, that's right. Great.
Excellent. Okay.
Okay, now JetBoy35 emails us and asks, what asset allocation tips can you give to independent investors? I invested an equal amount in stocks and UITFs. Should I invest more in either instrument? Should I have another investment avenue? What do you think?
No, the asset allocation is really dependent on your profile as an investor. What are your objectives? Mm-hmm. What is your time horizon? Mm-hmm. And are you afraid of risk, risk mm-hmm. averse, or mm-hmm. you are aggressive? Mm-hmm. So it really depends on that. Now, as for the what allocation would I recommend? You have to investigate first, who are you? What type of investor are you? If you are on the risky side, then go ahead. The stocks is doing very well right now. Mm-hmm. Go invest in stocks. And then if you are on the more conservative side, then probably you can look into corporate bonds mm-hmm. treasuries, mm-hmm. or the safer deposits.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so so depending on how he feels, just stocks or UITFs, whether he's conservative or
but
more risky.
Isn't it that in UITF there's also exposure to stocks, so you can choose.
Right. Exactly. That's right. So sometimes you start with UITFs and then you eventually graduate to individual stocks. Mm-hmm. So with UITFs, you get for 5,000 pesos, you get instant gratification.
Wrong principle, right?
Instant diversification.
Right.
And
like
then,
mutual
so eventually,
funds.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then eventually, if you like how it feels, mm-hmm. and then you want to graduate into the mm-hmm. riskier part, but you know, you can control mm-hmm. what kind
he
of stocks
like
you go
into.
He seems
like he's not so risk averse, since he already has stocks and UITFs. Mm-hmm. So maybe he can just continue doing that?
Diversify.
Just continue doing that. If you like the UITFs, how it's doing, and you want to go further into the market, deeper into the market, go ahead and buy some stocks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. So Steven says, I have a friend who takes profit after his stocks gain 10 to 15%. But another Barkada says, sayang if you cash in right away. How do you peg the ideal return for stock trading?
I love it when Mel says Tagalog words.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
She says it well though, huh?
Good
job,
okay,
Mel.
So
okay, so we get this.
Here.
Okay, you lost the question.
What's the answer here?
10, 15%.
Yeah. Is that good enough?
If you would look at it, how the stock market grows. In fact, it grew 100% with some companies.
Yeah.
10 to 15% might be very small, but there is no written rule.
There's
as
no hard
to
and fast rule.
No hard and fast rule. 10, 15, 20, 30. It depends again on you. Mm-hmm. What can you take?
Mm-hmm.
If you cannot sleep anymore and 60% growing, 80%, but you cannot sleep at night anymore, that it would suddenly drop, then that might
not
be
take your 15%,
for you.
Right? Yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Probably this friend of his is quite conservative and can't sleep. That's why he only does 10 to 15.
Or he's messing with his friend, right? He's saying, oh,
yeah. But there's a good strategy there. Sometimes, like, you go in and into the market and just leave a portion of the portfolio there, and you get maybe if it's 10 to 15%, but a portion, you get that, sort of put that in your pocket and then go back to the market and then just move it forward. So every time you try to get something, and you enjoy it already. Mm-hmm. You like the feeling, you're getting the money from there, and then you have
but
more incentive
more
to put
that's
more
growing,
in.
Yeah. That's actually a great idea. Mm-hmm. So you have your gratification now, but
then
you still have that other portion.
It's
that
still
continues
growing
to grow.
And it's still working for you.
That
makes
sense.
It's
well,
kind of the best of both worlds.
If I may add, another strategy might be to study technical analysis so that you would see the charts. The charts would tell you whether it's still going up or down.
That's right.
And that's an option as well.
Yeah.
If you're able to spend
analysis,
time and really
you have to know math there.
Yeah.
Forget
and if you like, there's some people that might like that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so Stephen, tell your friend. Now, May asks, Christmas is coming up and I'm psyching myself to stick to my budget. I'm really hoping I don't overspend so I don't end and start the year with a hole in my pocket. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that's been the case for almost 10 Christmases now.
She's
Can
honest.
Your hosts and your Q&A Friday guests give unique Christmas tipid tips?
Oh. 10 years and not getting
story
it.
Story of most people's lives.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
so let's hear tips.
Let me give an out of the box answer for that. I invite you to take a quiet one
Christmas.
Quiet day. No, just one quiet day for before the busy days of December, and try to do a life map. What is that? A graphical way of building in and writing your dreams and aspirations. Now, that life map supposedly should hopefully motivate you. No? So after doing that, you can do now your Christmas budgeting. Bonuses would come in. But then think about what significant thing can you do this year, this end of the year, for you to be able to take significant steps, big leap towards your life map.
The plan's there.
Yes.
So this helps you understand what your priorities are.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a framework of what you should spend on and what you
Because I'm sure for 10 years, she knows already all practical tips.
It's only 1 month away.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
So that life mapping should start right now.
Yeah. And also,
you're right, huh? Not just in December, started already.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be just Christmas time.
You
I
know,
think.
During Christmas time, it's so commercialized these days. You know, and just putting gifts in nice wrappers, and just giving to
all
everyone in the company.
Yeah. To just spend it again. And
but you really have to put down a budget per gift.
That's true. A budget per gift. And this is what I like doing in the last maybe 10 to 15 years. I look for nice places where I can buy cheap stuff, maybe buy the dozen or 20 or 100.
Or the cheap stuff.
I will show you that I can give you a gift that sells. You know, I can buy it only for 100, but it looks like a 500 peso gift.
You know what place is good? The Pitan Arcade.
The Pitan, I've been
there. Oh, wow. You should have an episode just on what you can find.
Yes.
I didn't hear about that.
Really.
How about thoughtfulness?
Yeah.
I mean, as a gift.
No, don't give me thoughtfulness in December.
You mean you're just
going
to say, I'm thinking
For you, it's
about
just a thought. No, but
Keep your thoughts to yourself,
Adrian. No, I'm talking about gifts that show thoughtfulness, especially if you're giving it to friends and everything,
right? You know, my kids, they give you a parang cards and they say, you know, I will give you a massage or something like that. Well, it makes sense, but not for us.
Yeah. For you guys, it's just a thought. Like I said, you will know that I thought about you. That's the cheapest gift ever.
Chocolate.
Oh,
there's
another way. There's another way. Like, you spend a lot for your pamangkins, right? A lot of these toys that just after a month, they don't work anymore.
Yes.
Okay, so instead of giving gifts, give them a party. Yeah, it's an event. Sure. Go as Santa or do something and then be very creative. You know, you will save a lot of money on those gifts.
That's right. This lady needs to do creative things. She can't do obviously the same thing she's been doing.
Go out of the box and not into another box.
She can find other ways of thinking of giving presents. No, yeah, that's right. Say that again, that last line.
Don't go out of the box and into another box.
That's right.
And maybe lift the box to the Lord.
Yeah.
This area to the God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Prayer will help.
Yeah, prayer will help.
Excellent.
Okay, anyway, send us your money questions via email, Facebook, or Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Wow, Christmas is coming, huh?
Got
to prepare.
Oh, it's my favorite part of the year. I go crazy during Christmas time.
Excellent. So wonderful discussions. Thank you again, Charms. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again on Monday for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money. Have a great weekend.